Biopharmaceutical companies are reliant on a dependable supply of raw materials to ensure they can produce life-saving medicines for patients. Raw material variability is not fully understood between suppliers and manufacturers, which impacts yield and process continuity. There's a lack of understanding of raw material attributes, which means the regulatory approach is not optimised, making changes difficult. The BioPhorum Raw Materials Programme brings the industry together using a strategic framework to guide collaboration. The programme provides connectivity and a shared language. It began by working on the biopharmaceutical industry drivers and objectively assessed working practices, systems, and processes. The more direction the industry can give to suppliers, the more consistency and control there will be. BioPhorum's strategic framework aims to solve urgent technical problems in management of raw materials. It will support the industry to gain greater knowledge of how raw materials are made, what they may contain, and what the performance expectations are. The framework is a tool to help maximise the resilience of the raw material supply chain in line with industry standards by setting clear goals and prioritisation needs. Encouraging advanced industry knowledge about attributes and impurities, creating flexibility by making second sourcing a reality, optimising limited lab resource, enabling predictable raw material performance. BioPhorum's Raw Materials Strategic Framework is a continuous improvement model that guides the industry on how to solve problems and drive the management of raw materials into the future. Join the conversation.
Welcome, everyone, to the Raw Materials Strategic Framework webinar and roundtable discussion, Future-Proofing Raw Materials for the Biologics Industry. My name is Janneke Kramer, and I am the Raw Material Program Lead and Facilitator. Today's event will be based around two sessions. Session one, we will spend 1 hour reviewing the raw material program and strategy presentation, followed by a Q&A discussion with our industry panel. During session two, we will host facilitated breakout roundtable discussions on three strategic topics related to our raw materials strategic framework. We hope that you'll enjoy the conversation, and at the end of the event, we will summarize the discussions in an event report that will be shared with participants of today's event. And the recording of the session one presentation will be made available on bioform.com. Important to note is that no references to companies or individuals will be made in shared materials without permission. The purpose of this event is to socialize the raw material framework and Bioform publications. Also, to encourage raw material industry to join, power in numbers, the Raw Materials Program. Collaborate on solving raw material challenges from material supply to ensuring product robustness, and to demonstrate the importance of implementing industry-aligned solutions and give example of how the Raw Materials Program deliverables can be applied. In BioPhorum, we create a safe environment within which to collaborate, and our code of conduct supports openness, and it is underlined by trust and confidence in how we operate. Session one, as mentioned, is being recorded for the purpose of sharing with the industry. To learn more about how we collect, keep, and process your private information, please view our privacy policy. The link will be pasted in the chat. All right, let's get started with our session one program. Thank you.
My name is Wade Nudson. I am with MilliporeSigma. I've been there for about 15 years. My background is in molecular biology with a history in cell culture media development. I moved from there into technical development, technical sales, technical operations, with a heavy focus on raw materials. Most recently, I am a manager in our process and technology group, and I've been there for about 4 years. I've been a part of BPOG since RMV03. Which is in 2016, I think. And I've been here with the revamping of the RMV program and the development of the GLT, the Joint Leadership Team, for the past 2 years. So I've been here through some evolution and those growing pains that we are today. So who are we and what do we do? We are a space for manufacturers and raw material suppliers to get together and develop a shared language to tackle common problems, specifically around raw materials, raw material variability, and the impact that variability has on product processes and product quality. Ultimately, we want to provide a unified voice for guidance and best practices, and eventually driving industry-wide change. To help focus these efforts, the GLT and the RMV group overall has developed a 5-year strategic framework to help prioritize where we focus our efforts. Now, before we get too deep into the woods, a quick general definition around raw materials, and that is simply to describe manufacturing ingredients that are consumed in the process that may or may not be still present in the final drug product. So we don't want to get too hung up on the granularity of what is a raw material. We're going to accept this and kind of go with it. Okay, what does this framework look like? There are 4 pillars here. Advancing industry knowledge, making second sourcing a reality, optimizing your lab resources, and enabling predictable raw material performance. I like to start discussing with the discussion with the enable predictable raw material performance, because I think then once you kind of do that, then you can see how it impacts those other 4 pillars. So this doesn't necessarily mean removing variability. Think of it more like understanding what and where that variability is, where it's coming from, and how to use that information to drive other activities, such as making second sourcing easier or optimizing your lab resources, or ultimately advancing industry knowledge. To describe this, I want to use a case study of work done within the RMV to highlight each of these areas. And that is surprising nobody probably is a focus on trace elements. And I want to walk you through the program that we did, the process that we went through, the outcomes that it generated, and where it fits in with some of these goals. So trace elements, as you know, are a critical component in cell culture media, whether you intend to put them there or not. Things like copper, manganese, they can have disproportionate effect on your cell culture processes, growth promotion, glycosylation profiles, ultimately product quality. So this is kind of where we wanted to focus. And like I say, back in 2018, I think when this program started, there were the RMV team sitting in a room, and everybody wanted to know what everybody else was doing, but not really willing to share too much yet until we knew what everybody else was willing to share. And so once we got around to discussing how to tackle this problem, what developed was a blinded ring study. What happened was that we created 5 samples, 3 media samples, 2 hydrolysis samples, spiked or unspiked with different trace elements, and sent them to each of the 16 participating labs. Those labs then used their own equipment, their own methodologies, their own expertise to analyze those samples, generate the data, and send that data back to the BPOG facilitator, who then anonymized it and sorted it in preparation for sharing back with the rest of the group. What we learned out of this ultimately is that really we all knew what we were doing. Everybody could test for trace elements with equitable degrees of expertise, that ICP-MS was capable of detecting down to single element part per billion of these elements that we were looking for, even in complex matrices like cell culture media or hydrolysates. And ultimately what came out of this was an update to the USP chapter 223 around testing for elements in chemically defined cell culture media. And that's kind of where we point at really advancing industry knowledge and really taking what we learned and creating industry-wide change. So how do we take this knowledge then and use it to make second sourcing a reality, to make it a little bit easier? Now you'll notice along the bottom some of these slides, there is a timeline. And what we try to do is to define short-term, mid-term, and long-term goals for each one of these pillars. A short-term goal in this particular case study is that having a standard method in place and knowing that you have those expertise and those methodologies in place, that really allows for focus on critical quality attributes that have an impact on cell culture performance and that final product quality. It also allows for a better understanding of the potential variability in your supply chain, which then can lead to better strategies to manage that variability, which ultimately leads to improved sourcing opportunities. Creating a standard methodology does allow data to be compared directly. And from a media manufacturer standpoint, now there are tools to assess and characterize both raw materials and final products to ensure that they meet specifications. Now, this isn't to say that the industry as a whole is ready to lay down hard specifications on copper or manganese content. I mean, there's still a lot of supply chain variabilities to consider, but now the tools exist to begin building that body of knowledge. So using this data to identify variability in your supply chain, and not just and with an emphasis on things like APIs or small molecules, but really now on cell culture media, or even hydrolysates, you can start thinking about robustness. How do you build robustness into your processes to lessen the impact of variability, to smooth over those peaks and valleys? For a cell culture media manufacturer standpoint, it also helps limit the proliferation of multiple specs for the same raw material. For example, I no longer need to have 15 piles of ferrous sulfate in my warehouse with 15 different TE specs and manage all of that inventory. This helps create a shared language between the media vendors and the biopharma manufacturers to more easily have those discussions and create the feedback loops around those critical quality attributes to build and create both shared interest and trust in the matter of methodologies and expertise and those attributes and what impacts them. So in terms of optimizing resources, creating these best practices in a common language also helps optimize resources in terms of lab space, in terms of personnel, in terms of transfer costs, for example. A really good example in this case is that if there is a standard test method, then you no longer need to go through the lengthy and potentially expensive test method development or test method transfer process across sites. You've got a starting place for newly developed processes, and you can reduce the amount of time spent optimizing processes from scratch when you can start with a standard process and go from there. In the cases of methods that require expensive equipment, expensive operating costs, or require substantial lab footprints, such as ICP-MS, you can even envision a future where these tests are not duplicated on the receiving end. You can actually take the data directly off the C of A and thus reduce the need for lab space if that data does not have to be replicated or duplicated. So how does our work on trace elements and standardizing ICP-MS methods for cell culture help enable predictable performance? As you begin to understand the variability in your supply chain, you can begin to prepare for it. Build robustness into your processes to better manage the variability at the point of use or absorb the impact of that variability and whatever impact it might have on your performance. So while we might not manage variability out of the supply chain, we can know enough about it to be ready for it when we see it. We can avoid those critical outliers and even help the N-1 or N-X suppliers understand the impact variability has and create a shared desire to help reduce it where we can, create the shared value opportunities. So from a conversation that we had in 2018, where a bunch of us were sitting around wanting to know what everybody else was doing, but feeling awkward about sharing too much about what we knew as individuals, we were eventually able to find common ground, collaborate not only via a lot of discussions, but actual studies for data collection, And this ultimately resulted in a new entry standard for testing trace elements in complex media. Through sharing of common problems and approaching solutions as a group, which culminate in guidance, best practices, or ultimately even new industry standards, this allows us to build a body of knowledge based on common tools, common languages, and called common understandings. And eventually we may get to the point where we have enough shared knowledge that we do have the sort of the shared database, the shared understanding of variability, trace element variability in the supply chain, knowing where it's coming from, knowing why it's there, what we can avoid, what we can't avoid, and how to absorb the impact of that variability in our processes. So I do want to leave you with a reminder that guidance and best practices are not the end goal of these projects. You really want to think of them as starting points, sort of that entry ticket towards industry change. We want to create a space where we can work together to build the trust necessary to collaborate towards that change. So as we move forward, and the goal here is what I want to leave you with is that this strategic framework can be used to help identify the specific needs that impact all of us and provide a structure for collaboration towards a solution. As we want to continue to drive our current projects towards sustainable change, and we want to invite those of you who are not yet members to give some thought to joining us as we move forward and tackle the next round of challenges. So that's what I have. Thank you very much. And I'll turn this back over to the facilitator for any further questions or comments.